So you said you want to start making slip joints, but you're new to the trade and you don't have the money to invest in this kind of tooling. Well, I'm about to show you why RUPLE gauge isn't really necessary and a really cheap and easy workaround just to get you started. Hey guys, welcome back. If you want to be a knife maker, if you want to just start doing this for a hobby or for a craft or for a trade, you have to be a problem solver, because there's only two kinds of knife makers. There's those with enough money to throw at a problem and those with enough problem solving capability to throw at a problem. And I don't even care how much money you have. Eventually you're going to come into a problem that you're going to actually have to solve that money's not going to fix. That's what we're going to talk about in this video. We're going to do a deep dive into the RUPLE dial, which is this device. And then I'm going to show you a workaround how to get around having one of these, because if you're just getting started, I know that money's tight. You don't have a couple of $100 to throw at a device that's only going to be used for one single purpose, and that is setting up your blade liner or your blade spring combination. But if you're just starting to get started at it and you want to know a nice, easy, cheap workaround, that's what we're going to talk about. So if you're ready to do that, then let's go down to the shop and let's do a deep dive and figure out what this thing is and how it works. So what we're looking at here is a device called a RUPLE gauge, or in some circles a rise fall indicator and rise and fall. So this is kind of essential to making custom slip joints and folders. Reason being is with a custom, we want this spring to lie flat in the closed, half stop, and open position. And that's what this indicator helps us do. Factory blades, as opposed to custom blades, don't really require that level of precision, because in most cases they don't even have a half stop. It's just rounded against the spring. So there's an open position and a closed position. In most cases, a factory blade won't have the half stop. It just has, it's rounded over here, so it just has a open and a closed position. But as custom makers, we want to make sure that we have that good solid open, close, and half stop, and that the blade should want to leap from position to position. Now we get started setting that up with this indicator. So it is essential, but don't worry, I'll show you how to get around it if you don't have one. So when we begin the setup, what our aim is that we check the knife and make sure that the knife is in all the proper configurations. It only has one pin for the center of the spring, because the actual position of the spring is generally irrelevant, because what we're really measuring is we're measuring this relationship that's going on up here, and how that spring moves is irrelevant, because it's going to move anyway when this part right here is the spring. This will all be stable in the handle, it will not move. So this measures the rise and fall of the spring. The fact that I have a bunch of excess back here is really irrelevant, because once I take it off, it'll end up being the exact same, because this is measuring the placement on the back of the spring right now. So when I set this up, I want to put a straight rod right in here in the spring, and the relationship I'm looking for is I want to make sure that, see, the top of the blade is relatively straight, and I want to make sure that there's more space here than there is right here. That way when I trim the spring, I can trim it in a straight line or in a gentle curve, as opposed to if this was higher, I would have to trim the spring and it would be a weird angle right there instead of being a seamless line. So once that's set up, we can make some minor adjustments. This screw will allow this plate to slide in and out to adjust the exact location of the spring. And like I said before, we needed that 70-degree angle right here. Now mine looks a little rough, but I still have the angle that's required. If we look at a factory knife, it's generally just stamped at 90 and it's real rough in there. That's no good. But it's stamped at 90, and they compensate by putting a little angle at the front. So you still end up with that same essential window through there. It's just not as big. And what happens is they function flawless when you get them, and then they get dirt and lint and stuff down in there, and they don't quite function right, or they get kind of mushy feeling. If you can see that little space gap. Well, we're doing that here, but we're getting a space gap on both. That way this corner never comes in contact with anything. The goal with this setup is to establish two points of contact. We have one here and one here. So there's our points of contact. And now as I rotate it, this will have 2 points of contact, but we'll adjust it later. And it's gonna be one about here, and this one's gonna be in about there. And then we have 2 points of contact in the closed position, which will be essentially the same as this one. And then one down here at the kick. So if you see where those points line up, there are your points of contact in relation to the blade. Now, anytime you change one of those, you change the relationship in the whole blade. So what's the initial goal is we're gonna try and set zero in the open position, and I'm gonna mark that. Reason being, I don't wanna make any adjustments to that because that's gonna be essentially my base of operations. And then at the half stop, I can adjust this to where it ends up where I want it to be, and it happens to be there now. So I can do that line, and that one's gonna be plus 0.005. So it's just a little high because we have some adjustments to make later. I think I'm reading it about 0.006, but that's okay. And then the final goal through the rotation is I want to make sure that there's enough room for my tip to clear, but keep in mind that this will be in a different position in the knife handle because it's not going to move like it does here. So I want to give myself just a little bit and never shorten the tip until it's in the knife. And then if you have to shorten the tip a little bit, you can do it then. But if you shorten it now, you're going to find that once you put it in the knife, it's going to end up way too short. So now that I'm in this position, I want to draw another line. And this one, it's pretty much where I want it to be, needs to be plus 0.015. And the reason that there's more there is because I have a little bit more adjustment that I might need to make on this side. Once these adjustments are done, I'll grind each of these. I'll get this flat done first, this whole setup here done first, and that'll be my zero, my start point. And then when I go to here, I'm gonna bring this down just a little bit. And if I want the blade tip to sit a little bit lower here, then I'll take more off of this point. If I want it to sit a little bit higher, I'll take more off of this point. And then once I get it sitting the way I want, then I can take it off evenly until I get down to 0.005, which is where I'm at. On the closed, it's essentially the same thing. I can take a little off of here and a little off of there, but I have to keep that radius going so I only have 2 points of contact with that radius. But if I want the tip to sit a little lower, I'll take it off of here. If I want it to sit a little higher, I'll take a little more off of here, maintaining that radius. And now I'm sitting at 0.13, so I can deal with that. I don't have a whole lot of adjustment left to make. So that's the essential relationships between them. Now, once you get all of those squared off, you're gonna have sharp corners on each of these, and you're gonna wanna round those corners because if you have a sharp corner, it's gonna bite and it's gonna start digging into your spring and causing problems. It may gall, it may just bind up, it may just feel gritty, and it may affect how flush your back is over time when you have this 55 to 60 Rockwell blade digging into this 40 to 45 Rockwell spring. It will eventually, something's gotta give. So we round those corners off, and you'll notice that once you take this corner off, since you're essentially taking off this little bit of a corner, that you're gonna change the relationship of the spring. So when this rounds off, your dial's gonna drop below zero, and then you reset it to zero, and then everything else is gonna be high. So if once I've reset it to zero and I come here, it's gonna, instead of reading 0.005, it may read 0.010 or 0.015 or 0.025 even. And that's because I changed the dial. It didn't actually grow metal on any of these two faces, but the dial was retarded because I lost material here and I had to compensate for it. So once this is done, the next thing I'm gonna set up is I'm gonna go in here and I'm gonna set this up, and I'm gonna take off from those two points how I want them to get the tip set down, and then I'm gonna round that corner, and it's gonna change it a little bit, and I'm gonna keep going until I get that corner nice and rounded and get this sitting about where I want at 0.015. And then I'm gonna go to the center. Remember, it should already be squared up. It should already be what I want, but I can take a little bit off and then touch off the corners, and then take a little bit off and touch off the corners, and then keep going back and forth. Now you can imagine if I was trying to assemble the knife, check it, and then put it back together, assemble, disassemble, and do this, it would be extremely tedious and take forever. So the point of this gauge is to get us in that ballpark. So once this gauge gets us into the ballpark and these numbers that I've indicated here, that's when we'll go and we'll start building our handles and our liners if we're doing liners. Just always remember that this works on a relationship between the three sides and the center pin. So this is a relational device, which means that if you don't have one, there's another way to do it, and I'll show you that in a minute. So it's crucial for you to understand how that relationship works, how these points of contact work. Now, so the reason we don't take them down to zero is because we have some minor changes to make. What will happen is once I put it in the liner, I'm going to probably take out a little bit here or a little bit here in this arc just to make sure that everything sits the way I want it to. Another thing I'll do is, since we have these two points of contact and these two points of contact, I'm going to want to make sure that all I have here is two points of contact. So I'll actually take a small arc out of this. So the only thing making contact are those two points of contact on the end. So once that small arc is out of there, what it'll eliminate is that half stop. If you leave that flat surface in contact with that other flat surface, you'll get like a blade wobble instead of having those two solid points of contact that make it want to jump from position to position. So that's why we leave a little extra on, because we have a little bit of fine tuning to do on this mechanism once it's in pre-assembly in the handle scales, liners, and other pieces that we're doing. So I had to take a break and bring you back up here, but I got to tell you that a couple of years ago, when I first started learning about how to make slip joints, I only made a few and then I kind of gave it up for a long time. But when I first learned how, Luke Swenson was coming up to visit from Lake Hills, Texas, and he sent me this grainy, nasty picture of a RUPLE dial, and he said, "Hey, you're going to need one of these if we're going to make a slip joint." And he didn't explain what it was or how it worked or anything. I was completely baffled. So I had to do a bunch of searching, Google image searches, until I found something that looked close, and then figure out what it was and figure out how it worked. And then armed with that knowledge, then I figured out what I had in the shop to work with, and I made one. And I know now that I could have taken some more shortcuts. This is the one I made 3 or 4 years ago, and I'm still using it. There's no reason to replace it or pay the couple of $100 for one that's just a little bit cleaner on the machining. But I know that not everybody has the capabilities that I have, and that's why I'm going to show this next method, because you don't have to be able to make one. You have to know how it works. And once you know how it works, then you can kind of improvise with a block of wood or the method I'm about to show you. It really doesn't matter. It's not money intensive, it's ingenuity intensive. So let's go back to the shop and check that out. So now, if you're anything like me and most of the other knife makers that I know, when you first start this hobby, trade, craft, whatever you want to call it, we are literally Johnny on a budget. And maybe you're lucky enough to get your hands on a grizzly grinder or something to start going, and you may not have the money or the other equipment or experience to build a RUPLE gauge like I built, and you certainly don't have the money to buy one. You can get them at most knife making supply places, but they're not cheap. They're very expensive. But you can work without it, especially if you're just getting started and you want to make your first few knives so you can really learn and understand the intricacies of the mechanism. So I have a way that I'm going to show you that requires nothing more than a $20-$25 indicator set from Harbor Freight. And then I'll remove the indicator, and I'll show you one more way to do it on like straight up budget with no indicator whatsoever. Okay, so what I have set up here is essentially two L-shaped stainless steel welding rod pins. This one's about the same size, and this one's the same thing with a longer handle. So I got access to the handle back here. And I'll set this up, I'll put the blade in, and I'll clamp it just snug enough to hold it in place. And that should be loose enough to where I can move this in and out just a little bit. Essentially the same operation as what's going on in the RUPLE gauge. So once I set it up, what I want to do is I want to ensure that I still have more space here than there. It probably doesn't look like it from your angle, but it's set up correctly. This is a little bit wider between the rod and the top of the knife, of the straight flat of the back of the knife. than there is right here. So that's set up correctly. Now, the thing you don't have on this setup is you don't have the spring. You actually have to hold the spring tension because this doesn't really have enough spring tension to hold up. You want to hold spring tension on the back of the spring, and then you can check your rotation exactly the same way. So let me zero that out and we'll see where we're at. Remember, these pins are probably not identical in spacing to what I had already had set up on the RUPLE gauge, so I may get a couple of different readings, because remember, like I said, it's all about the relationship between the spring, the notch, and since the relationship has changed, moving it to here, the numbers might change a little. It doesn't mean that they're wrong or that this is inaccurate, but if you start with this and you get this relationship set up just right, then your numbers will be consistent as you go back and forth to tune up the knife, and that's really what's important. So as I drop it, I'm at zero now. So on this one, I'm pulling a little more than five, looking like about seven. And then in the closed position, it's pulling about 20. So most definitely the relationship has changed slightly, but if this was the proper relationship and I could go back and forth and work on it on the grinder, then I'm all set up and I paid 20, 25 bucks and then used whatever vice I have in the shop to do it and saved the few hundred dollars that it would cost me to buy an actual RUPLE gauge. Now, assuming that I'm really, really on a budget and I just want to try it one time and see how to do it, then I don't need the gauge. I'm still gonna set this up the same way. I'm just gonna hold this against the spring. I'm gonna make sure that I get the same relationship in the notch, and I'm gonna make sure, once again, that there's the proper spacing here and here. So now that I know that that relationship is the same, correct, and everything functions the way it's supposed to, it's kinda hanging up on the vice jaw, but that's okay. Now, as I go back and I start doing my fine tuning, I can do a blue line right on the vise, and then as I adjust this, if it's falling too high or too low, I'll be able to read that on the line. I'll be able to see on the line that I am too high or too low, and I can make subtle adjustments off of that. Another even better way is, once this is set up, I can come in here and give it a little mark on each of those edges. I need a straight up line right there. I give a little tiny line right there. So now I know that that line lines up with the back of the spine of the knife. So relationally, that's where it should end up, because this will eventually be the back of the knife when I clean everything off. So relationally, that should all end up the same. So I can rotate it and I can see that those line up pretty good, and I can rotate it back and see that those line up pretty good. Maybe just a little high, which it is actually. It's, you know, it's a couple thousand, 15 thousandths high. So this is a good way to get roughly in the ballpark. You're still gonna have to do the back and forth where you assemble and disassemble the knife and fine tune the adjustments. You're gonna have a little bit more work to do on that end, but it's gonna be a lot cheaper up front to get started and start doing this without having to invest a bunch of money in equipment that you don't know if you're ever gonna use again. So now for me, it's time to put this back on the RUPLE gauge, make some fine-tune adjustments, and then start working on the handles. All right, guys, I know we didn't get much farther in the knife build, but I felt that it was real important that you understood that particular tool, because you're gonna see it a lot, in not only in this build, but in future builds. And if you wanna start doing this, it's kind of essential that you understand how that works and that you get one for yourself. That was a pretty cool budget-friendly workaround for just about any financial situation. I hope that you see with that video that you can pretty much make or fudge your way around anything that you need in the shop if you understand the mechanics and the principle behind it. I hope that even if you had one, that maybe you learned a little bit about its functionality and its purpose from that video. But if you didn't, you know, the next video, maybe you will. Speaking of the next video, we're gonna get back down in the shop and we're gonna get working on the handle scales. This is going to be a real simple shadow trapper, so it's just going to be scales, spring, and blade. There's not going to be any liners or anything on this particular one. And then when we're done, we're going to give it away. So if you're not subscribed, subscribe, because once we finish building it, on my live show at 18:30 on Sunday, we're going to go ahead and just give it away to one of the people who are present for the live show. So you're going to have to start tuning into that live show and be present if you want to win this knife. So if you're not subscribed, go ahead and hit that subscribe button so you get notifications when I go live and when I post more videos and updates in this series. Like I said, the next one, we're gonna start getting back to work on the knife. I just figured that you might need to know how that tool works, because if you're gonna start making slip joints, this is one of the tools that you're gonna need to figure out how to improvise or throw money at. All right, guys, I won't take up any more of your time. Thanks for hanging out with me. Thanks for watching this video. Don't forget to catch me live at 18:30 Pacific Standard Time on Sundays. And Norseman out.